Welcome to another episode of It's a Long Road, the Rambo Series podcast. I am your host, Ryan, and with me today I have a very special guest, Mr. Dominic Tartamella. Tartamella.
Yes, sir. You got it. That nice Italian stallion name right there.
You're like the third, at least third or fourth Italian I've had on as a guest host. And that scene from Rocky II, I haven't seen so many Italians in one place. Do you remember that? Yeah. Can you explain why the other host was, whether it was Stu Nahan or what was the other guy's name, Baldwin? Why was that offensive? Is that an offensive thing to say?
I didn't take it offensive. I don't know. I'm not somebody who gets easily offended. So,
well, I know you're not. You know? That's why I like you. I like your humor and I like the cut of your jib. And we'll get to some of that in a second here. But I'm just curious, as an Italian, when you see that scene, I'm confused because especially in 1979 to be concerned about.
Right, right. I don't know. I guess there was a little bit of a prejudice back then. I don't know.
Fair enough.
I never felt it.
Okay, so Dom, you are a podcast creator yourself. Let's start with that. Right now you're running a podcast called Movie Thoughts, and you do that solo. Movie Thoughts. What's that like?
I do that solo. So I used to do a podcast that I tried to do with my brother, which was called Genuine Reels Movie Podcast.
Which and, I listened to. Down which and, I listened to.
Yes. And we did. We had some fun on there, you know, but it's always hard getting, I mean, you know how it is. You're always podcasting and it's hard to get everybody on the same page, the same day. And I'm always watching movies, so I have these thoughts in my head. So I said, you know what? I'm just going to start going at it by myself. At least I don't have to, you know, commit to anybody or go on anybody's schedule. So
no,
that's why I started doing it.
I feel you on my Rocky podcast. I have two co-hosts, and every now and then one of them can't make it. And that's partly why I got two co-hosts, because the show can go on with me and the other. Right,
so it's very smart. Yeah. Very smart.
and then for
interchangeable.
For sure. For the most part, they're always on. That's Katie and Kyle. They're awesome.
That's good. That's good.
And then for the Rambo one, it's like I wanted to do Rambo, and I was like, do I really want to? Who am I going to ask to commit to doing this weekly or biweekly, I should say? And
who wants to talk about Rambo that much?
There might be nobody. It might just be me. In fact, I am the only. I'm the only Rambo podcast that does it this way. I've checked. I mean, of course, other podcasts discuss, you know, they have a Rambo 2 episode or, you know, you know, there's 1,000 action podcasts. So these films have been covered, but I think I'm the only one that does it scene by scene. And so I thought,
right, it's cool.
Thank you. Yeah. And I thought it'd be fun to have different voices with me each episode. Mm-hmm. Some have been repeating, of course, guest hosts, but the idea would be we have a rotating creators on, and we usually get people that do podcasts, because I hate to say it, no offense to people that aren't podcasters, and I've had a couple on the show that aren't, and they do fine, but you can always kind of tell the ones that are kind of comfortable behind the mic.
I got you.
Yeah. And you're certainly one of those people. So anyways, thanks for coming on, and you do the Movie Thoughts,
which
I listen to, but I haven't heard every episode. The reason being is because you're so up to date with your films. I'm like, you just reviewed Cocaine Bear. Like, what the? Like, you're probably the
first. Exactly. That's why I had to do a podcast, because I'm always at the movies anyway. Okay. I'm always going to see movies, so I'm like, I couldn't let that get lost, you know?
Well, without spoiling, I'm just curious. Was Cocaine Bear as fun as it should be?
I wanted it to be a little funner, honestly. But it was okay. It wasn't a bad movie, you know?
It's based on a true story.
They could have been. Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, Cocaine Bear is not about a gay man with a beard who does a lot of cocaine in the 80s. We should make that clear. It's literally about a bear who snuffed a lot of cocaine.
There might be a film that comes out, you know, after you saying that, there's definitely an audience for that one as well.
Sure, absolutely. Okay, and so, yeah, I've listened to every episode that I've seen the movie to, if that makes sense. And,
okay, cool. Thank you.
You say some funny stuff, which I love. Your humor's great. Your breakdowns are fair, and I think I've agreed with everything that you've said about the film. I think the only I should have been better prepared. I mean, I wasn't taking notes when I was listening to the show, but I remember you did not like Halloween Ends at all. I remember that. And I actually enjoyed it.
As I sip from my Halloween mug.
Yeah, as your Halloween mug. And I understand you're a huge Halloween fan, and so am I. I love the Halloween franchise. In fact, you know it much better than I do. So I think you're a bigger fan. So maybe being a bigger fan is probably why you didn't like Halloween ends, if that makes sense. Whereas me, I'm a casual. I enjoy them. And so
I will say I've watched it a couple more times and I've come around a little bit to it. You know, I think once I accepted, you know, I talk about that on my podcast, the expectations of going in a movie when you're expecting something. Right. Sure. I, now that I know what it is, I could, you know, take it as it was made. You know, like, all right, not a lot of Michael Myers, and that's fine. I'll deal with it.
Yeah, you'll live. As we always do with the show when I have a new guest co-host on, we talk about first, what is your fandom of Sly, your fandom of the Rambo franchise as a whole, and then, generally speaking, your overall fandom of Rambo 3, because that's the movie we're on right now. So I know you're a Sly fan. That's probably why our world's connected over these years on social media.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, I want to say you do a pretty darn good Arnold impersonation. Sorry, Arnold. Because let's talk about you do Arnold as well. You do good impersonations and you do comedy reels that I literally totally have laughed out loud. And you did Rocky and Rocky 2, I believe, in character of Pauly Adrian. Remember that? Like Rocky 2 in a nutshell. Yes. I shared
gotta
that.
Gotta do another one.
Dude, those are so good.
I thank you, man. I think I left off on 3 or 4, but I wanted to even do – I might have. I might have just did 3, honestly. Okay. I know I did 3 because I know I was doing the Sylvester Stallone, no, after Mickey died.
Yeah, I love that. The guttural yell of Rocky when Mickey dies.
Yeah, I gotta do more of those because I honestly I'm a sucker for Rocky 5 too.
Awesome. So. And what is the name of the channel?
Genuine Reels.
That's right.
It would be. Yeah. That's right. I think if you go down the more recent, because I don't really post on YouTube as often as I do, you'll probably find at least the last one, the third one.
Because you put them on Facebook as well, but they're great. I've shared them on Facebook. You've done some Sopranos.
Thanks so much, man. Yeah.
Well, because you're from New York, Staten Island, right?
Yes.
So you've got that.
Staten Island. I got that accent going.
Well, that's the thing. Like, I'm Canadian, Western Canada. I've been here my whole life, of course. And I've seen you guys. I do the quotation marks. Anyway,
you guys.
You know, on TV shows and stuff. And it's just, it's like, is that a fake accent? Are they just doing this for the TV movie shows? But that's how you guys talk. It's just, it kills me. I love it.
Well, if I was Robert De Niro, taxi driver, I'd say, you talking to me? Huh? You talking to me?
Yes, I am, sir. Can I go to what's the best place I should visit for? Statue of Liberty.
Statue? Why you want to go to the Statue of Liberty? Come on, what do you want to go to Statue of Liberty?
Well, it's the lady, you know, the skirt, and she's got the torch. Anyways, I love the accent. It's fun.
I appreciate it, man.
And they gotta do it. Well, if you say I appreciate it, you got to do it in the Sly voice.
I will appreciate it, man.
There you go.
Tell you the truth, I never use them, you know?
I never use my accents. Okay, well, so you're a Sly fan. So when did that begin for you?
Oh, man. At a very young age. My father is a big Sylvester Stallone fan. He always has been. So that, like, just dumped onto me and my brother. I mean, at a young age, we were watching everything from Rambo, Rocky, Cobra at a young age. Nice. Which is... Honestly, Cobra's a horror movie.
It is. It's one of the grossest films Sly's ever done as far as like content. And it's a dirty film. It's just something weird about that.
And I just remember watching that as a kid and honestly being scared because especially I forget the villain, that guy, what his name is.
Yeah, I forget everything. Every time I watch that film, it dumps. My brain dumps that film every time. My brain's like, you do not need to hold on to this.
Necessity.
You don't need to hold on to this. There's only so much room in your brain.
You don't need to retain anything from Cobra. You need to drop it off. It's just better for you.
Man,
but so he just, you know, watched all those movies. And my father was the kind of guy, too. He wouldn't, like, if he was watching TV, he's not going to, you know, change it and put on something, you know, more kid-friendly for his young sons.
Yeah, we're like that, too.
So he would just leave it on. And that's where my love started, you know, seeing everything. Like I said, Demolition Man, Cliffhanger, all that stuff.
Awesome. Okay, so now the Rambo franchise. What was your first memory of the first film you saw in the Rambo franchise?
I know seeing... It was probably, honestly, bits and pieces of, like, Rambo 2 and Rambo 3.
Sure.
Because I know, like, that was another thing, too. My father had them recorded. So I'd always constantly have videos of, like, you know, Rocky marathons and whatever on VHS. So I'm pretty sure it would have been 2, probably. You know, I just remember that Sylvester Stallone in that shape with that hair, you know, spraying machine gun bullets.
Well, talking about hair, Rambo 3. His hair.
Jesus. I am envious. Every time I watch this movie, I'm envious.
Well, do you want to say why? I mean, just for our listeners, maybe.
I'm bald. I'm obvious. I got the hairline of Hulk Hogan if I grew out my hair.
Maybe you should.
My brother's, but my, you know, the best part is I have an older brother, and he's only a year older than me, but he has all his hair. And he's always busting my balls. Oh, gee, why don't you grow it out? You know, get the whole thunder lips in the flesh, baby.
Scullet, you'll have a scullet going. Yeah. Yeah, Hogan was the first celebrity that rocked the scullet.
Yeah, man. And he must have lost it young, too. I mean, because
he was 28. For the record, he was 28. He was 28 in Rocky III.
He got better mileage out of his hair than I did, because I started like losing mine like 21, honestly.
Well, who knows when he started losing? I'm just saying that was his first big, you know,
28 breakthrough. Jesus.
But he was 20. I know he's 28 really out of 50 in that film. It's weird. Oh my!
I was just gonna say that. Yeah, like he really. It's really funny. They say that, you know, everybody used to look older and stuff like that. It's true. Wow, he looks like he really does look like he's 50.
But he aged really well. I'll give him credit. I mean, mm-hmm. not the side. I mean, I'm a bit of a Hogan mark. You know, I like Hogan and
yes,
but right. he says some things he probably shouldn't say. And but you know,
of course.
At the end of the day, like he was my guy. I mean, I'm an 80s kid. I was absolutely. Born in 75. I remember the Hogan slamming Andre. I was 8 years old, and that is an indelible memory in my head that will never go away. We went to school the next day talking to, like, did you see?
Right.
You know, yeah.
He body slammed him.
Yeah. I used to stay up for Saturday night's main event. It was like pay-per-view for me, man. It was pay-per-view.
Yeah,
UFC main events have nothing on the Saturday night's main event in the 80s.
Like, I watch it from time to time now, but me and my brother, too, growing up, big wrestling fans.
Yeah, I figured.
We were into all that stuff.
Being from New York. Mm-hmm. Being from New York.
You gotta love it.
All right, so now with Rambo 3, what's your overall fandom or lack of fandom regarding Rambo 3
as a Rambo film? 3, I gotta be honest with you, it's not my favorite.
Oh,
Rambo
really? That's weird. That's a hot take.
it's probably my least favorite, even with the new one. I think it's always kind of forgotten to me. I don't know what it is. Whenever I get in the mood to watch the Rambos and I, you know, knock them all out, 3 is always been tough getting through for some reason.
Interesting. Okay.
I don't know what it is. Rewatching it for this,
please.
I felt a little bit better. You know, it's still kind of the
same way. I don't know. Maybe because I'm covering it and I'm doing it for the podcast, and so I'm not having fun. Look, we're not critiquing this film. And I do with the Rocky film. So on my Rocky podcast, again, if you're listening to this Rambo podcast, you don't realize I do a, not you, I mean obviously the audience that I'm listening, but I do a Rocky podcast called One More Round. We're doing the same thing. We break it down the same way. We go through the films. We're on Rocky 2 right now, scene by scene with my co-host. Regarding doing this process with the Rambo films, I find that I'm just enjoying Rambo 3 more than it deserves, but who cares? I guess as I get older too, who cares? It's a Rambo film.
Yeah, I realized that about myself as well. Like, I used to be, and I'm still passionate about movies and stuff like that, but I used to be, I want to say I used to be more of a whiny brat when it came to movies. Like, if I didn't like a movie, I'd be like, this movie sucks, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
But now I take it for what it is. Even though Rambo 3 is not my favorite, it's still enjoyable.
Yeah, so if we compare it to the other Rambo films, and that's natural to do that, to compare this character's film to other, we do it with Marvel films, we do it with Star Wars films, to compare, but if you just watch it as an action film, it's an action film. It's fun.
Oh, yeah. It's Sylvester Stallone in his prime.
Yeah, he's a peak physical condition.
Peak physical.
Yeah, his mullet has never looked better.
Amazing.
He's a beautiful-looking specimen. And I believe as you watch, especially as we watch today's scenes, I noticed during these scenes in particular, in this movie in particular, I think he got lip work done.
Really? That's possible.
I don't know if it's because he has like zero fat in his face, but it's all in his lips. But he just kind of has it just seems to be more of a
just
a little bit more kissy-kissy.
Right.
It just seems to go out more like a pufferfish. I could be wrong.
Right.
But
I could see that.
Yeah. Let me know what you think when we get to it. Okay.
Yes, definitely.
I think Rambo 3 is silly, bonkers, but has some great action sequences. I think the action set pieces are fun. But yes, overall, Rambo's character doesn't seem like Rambo's character. He's more comedy. We have some comedy bits coming up in our
scene here. Right.
Yeah. And I am going to piece together, hopefully nobody beats me to it, but I'm going to piece together all of his one-liner comic bits and do like Rambo 3, the sitcom, with the laugh track.
I'd love to see that.
It's just like a little, just like, it turns blue and the crowd laughter. And then
I love Stallone. I love Schwarzenegger. I think Schwarzenegger takes the cake on like doing the comedy. I think he always did comedy a little bit better than Stallone.
He has the advantage. I'll tell you why he does. The accent, he's a foreigner, so that's always funnier. It's always funnier when you don't speak properly.
And right, right.
So that's automatic comedy gold. He's always that fish out of water. So when he's in Twins and Kindergarten Cop, and then he's huge. He's just a huge man. It's got nothing to do with
huge.
He's just a big boy, right? So when he's doing Kindergarten Cop, you know, he's working with kids. Like, it wouldn't be funny if Sly did. Not because Sly couldn't necessarily be funny in the same role, but like beat for beat, line for line. It's just because
right.
Arnold's huge working with little kindergarten kids. So that spectacle of the big with the child, it's not a tumor.
It's not a tumor.
Like, it's just, it's more silly with Arnold. So he has the advantage of looking different.
And I think one thing about him too is he's in on the joke. He knows what's funny about it. Whereas like maybe somebody else might not. They wouldn't understand why their accent's funny and stuff like that. I think he overdoes it on purpose in those roles too. Like,
I don't know if Sly, I think in his peak ego days, which he admits that he did, would allow himself to be silly. And so when he tried to do a stop or my mom will shoot, it was like, whoa, slow down. That's a little bit, yeah. Yeah, that's a fun film. Okay. So, all right. So there you go. So that's your overall fandom of course, the films and Rambo 3. And so as we always do on the show, and as you know, we are going to now just watch where we are in the film now. We'll stop. We'll talk about it. We'll crack wise and see how far we get. We left off with Rambo, of course, saying that he's going to go get Trautman. He's going to do a one-man mission. Actually, no, he said I could use a few of you. That's right. He told the village leaders, I could use a few of you. If you don't mind coming on a suicide run. And the guy,
few of you want to die with me.
Yeah. And the leader's like, we don't mind dying. We're already dead, which is a very depressing. Remember that speech?
That's honestly how I live my life, though.
Yeah, sure. I'm already dead. Whatever. I do admit there's times where when I tell this like to my wife, like when I'm working on bills and raising the kids and then I'm working towards my retirement and I'm retired from the military in 5 years. I'm doing all this just so I can die. It's a weird, what are we doing? Like we're basically
set yourself up great, you know,
like we're preparing ourselves to be buried. My whole life exists to prolong my death as long as I can.
Exactly.
Ugh.
And then just do it anyways.
So. Yeah. So really the Afghan army here, what they called again? The Mushaga Dweens or what?
Something. The Mushagana. Yeah.
The Mushaganas. Actually, the Mushaganas were a great doo-wop artist in the
60s. Oh, were they?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, well.
Yeah. I really enjoyed them. So Rambo's letting them consult with each other to figure out how to best go about this. But back on the Russian base, of course, they got word that, hey, Rambo, this guy who works with the American prisoner, is now being working with this hospital camp, so to speak. So now, of course, the Russians only have one. So it's weird. They heard that one white American is working with the Afghan. You know, they're sending out the whole army to take out Trautman.
One man. Yeah. One man with a mullet and a hell of a belt is there.
So they send out an arsenal to take this village out. Yeah, it's like burning down your house when you have a spider in it. But here we go.
Right, right.
Actually, did you rewatch this film recently? Because I had a question for you if you had.
I did, yeah.
What's your understanding of Trautman's mission? when he got caught, we talked about, I don't know if you heard the episode where we talked about that. They were driving on a road. Why would they ever operate like that?
My theory is that he wanted to get captured, so Rambo would come and do the heavy lifting.
That's amazing.
So he had no game plan.
That was his plan. We're playing checkers here, and Trout was playing chess.
Yeah, he's playing chess. He's like, I'm going to get captured. I'll get Rambo over here. He don't want to come. I'll get him over here.
Done. There's nothing else to say. That's fantastic. Okay.
Do not worry. They will decide soon.
You have to get in there tonight.
What is your name?
Zahami, Zah. This boy is very hard inside. His parents were killed last year. His brother died in the fort where the American is. He looks like a boy, but he fights like a man.
Are we allowed to say that today?
You can't. Is he a man? Does he identify as a man? I don't know.
I don't know. I don't think he's had an opportunity yet. I think
this guy's doing a lot of assuming here.
Yeah, he's assuming that he looks like a boy, but he fights. So this poor kid, his parents got killed during the war here. And then his brother got killed in that same camp that Troutman's in.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Let me just say the wrong brother died because this kid's annoying. They should have taken this boy and killed him in the camp because this kid is annoying as F, as they say.
He's definitely annoying.
Now, okay, I'm in the Navy, and okay. I've been to many foreign ports in the world. So I've been mm-hmm. the white guy in the ports. You know, I step off the ship.
You're telling me you've been the Rambo.
I've been the Rambo in these situations where you'll have kids come up to you trying to sell you chiclets, or you have others try to proposition you for a relation. You know, those kind of things. It's real, man. And so when you step off the boat and you're the white guy in a non-white country, is all I'll say, you are the object mm-hmm. of a lot of questions, poking, prodding, and follow me. And right. my friend, a lot of my friends.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you ever give a child your massive knife to play with?
No, I took it back. You know, they asked for it, but I just like Rambo, I gave it back. He goes, no. This whole sequence is designed to show that Rambo, as tough as he is, you know, he's this tough, manly, you know, soldier, but he's able to hold and be patient enough to have an annoying kid asking all these questions and poking. It's to show you that he's gentle at the same time.
Gentle side.
Yeah. So let's watch a little bit of this interaction. So the boy is going to, so for our listeners, of course, the boy is talking to Rambo, talking to him about, Donald just in our chat just said, did they offer you a shoe shine? No. shine, shoe shine. I never take a foreign box from anybody. I'm telling you right now, if some kid hands me a box, I ain't opening
shoe
it.
Shine, he's got the big amount. I can't find your legs.
That was about the same time he did Rocky 3. So he was really getting that.
Oh, he was doing it. He was getting the emotion. I think he was going for acting Oscar, I think, you know.
Okay, let's be honest. That scene in First Blood, that was his Oscar scene.
Oh, listen, it was there. He was good. Yeah. I mean,
don't get me wrong. It was good, but have you watched it with captions? Because you'll be surprised what you've
done. You know what?
Before.
I don't think I have.
Okay.
I don't think I have. I have to do that.
Yeah. Well, even if you go back and listen to the episode that I did, if you want, we break down what he says because there's things you didn't, I guarantee you did not catch. You did.
Right. Yeah. That's actually too, in Rocky 1 when he throws Mick out of the apartment.
Yeah.
Sticks. I don't know. I got to watch that with captions too.
Oh, what's another one that we got with captions? There's a lot of stuff. Watch the first Rocky film with subtitles. Watch the first. Mm. I guarantee you there is dialogue you never caught before. Guaranteed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No matter how many times I've seen it, when you watch the captions, like, I never. Yeah. Okay, so this boy's not going to poke and pry. He's going to ask about the knife. He's going to ask about the necklace. He's going to ask if the necklace turns blue. Let's see here. All right.
What is your name?
Rambo.
Where are you from?
Arizona.
Why did he say Rambo?
Yeah, because that's what's on the movie poster.
I know, come on. But I mean, he knows he's the Rambo marquee. Like, I'm the title character called Rambo. But Troutman obviously calls him Johnny. Why would I ever say, I'm Rebalkan? What?
I feel like they do that on purpose, too, because Troutman calls him John. He's the father figure. He's the only person. Like, he really doesn't ever get called John by anybody else.
No, but that's his name. But I mean,
It's his name. I mean, that's like me introducing myself as Tartamella.
Yeah, hi. Nice to meet you. I'm Rebalkan. Nice to meet you. This kid has no idea about the Troutman relationship. The Troutman relationship is us as the audience. We know that relationship. Right. But why does Rambo equate everyone's relationship to him what Troutman refers to? Like, only Troutman gets to call me Johnny. It's ridiculous.
That's basically what it is.
Now, this is a nice little Rambo lore because this is the first film. Now, if you read the books, we would know this. I mean, I have read the books. So but if you're just a Rambo film goer and haven't read the books, now we're getting a little bit of Rambo history. He's from Arizona.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, right. He never says actually where he's from.
No, not verbally that I'm aware of anywhere in the film, so we get an indication of where he's from. So he's from, of course, we find
just
Rambo 5, he goes, that's where we see him.
Right.
Yeah, I do like that little continuity. I'll give him full credit for that, for the Rambo, the fourth Rambo film, referred to as Rambo. It's ridiculous. And then
oh, God, I could talk about that for hours. Stuff like that drives me crazy.
And then from there, they go, what's the second film? You know, well, it's Rambo First Blood Part 2. Great. And then they're looking for Rambo 3, but where's Rambo 2? And then Rambo's the fourth film. So you would think Rambo was the first film. Rambo 3 is the sequel to that first film. Where's Rambo 2? It doesn't exist. It's called... Yeah, you get it.
It's a mess. And it's the worst, I think, for like future generations, too. I mean, obviously, they could look it up and stuff like that. But
right, Google.
If you're just going to watch a movie, what is Rambo? Just called Rambo?
It's, to this day, and I'll say it again when I get to season 4, when we cover the fourth Rambo film, I don't know why they didn't call it John Rambo. That is such a kick-ass title.
Yeah, there's a different cut on the Blu-ray, too. There's a cut that I think they do call it John Rambo.
Okay.
And, with a couple of additional scenes.
I might have to buy the film.
Yeah.
I might have the hard copy buy the film because I don't have that cut. And I think maybe when I do that season, I should probably do, you know, because I'm only going to do it once. I may as well do the director's cut.
Right.
At the same time, because Sly came back doing Rocky Balboa in 2006, and they called it Rocky Balboa, which is such a kick-ass title. Rocky Balboa. Mm-hmm. And then John Rambo would have been a great nod to his other franchise, John Rambo. I don't know why.
Right. I guess that comes down to the studio and marketability and all that shit. You know?
I guess. Okay, so here, I worked something out, by the way, so you're going to hear something here. So here's the next comedy little bit. The boy asked this question.
So now, how much days walk?
Oh, about 2 years.
Okay. So if you didn't quite catch that, the boy's asking, Arizona, how many days walk? The idea, of course, being they're in this village. To this child, everything is just around the area, you know, by horseback, walk. Arizona is just another Middle Eastern province somewhere, you know, not understanding that it's in the United States of America. So he says it's about 2 years.
Are you a soldier?
No more.
I am a soldier.
Yeah.
Are you here to fight?
No.
Rambo, he's so weird. Are you a soldier? Well, not any. No more. Oh, true. You're not enlisted with the military anymore. But have you forgot the events of Rambo 2? I mean, you literally destroyed Vietnam. Granted, he's retired. He's a Tibetan now. He's a Buddhist, as you know. He's a Buddhist.
He doesn't want to take blame for anything, you know. No, I'm not a soldier anymore.
He's not going to rescue Troutman, but with peace talks. So it's weird that he says no more.
He's going to kill everyone.
Yeah, my intention is to get Troutman out via violence, but I'm not a soldier anymore. What did he ask here? Are you here to fight? Again, why would he say no? He's literally got a knife on him. He's here to rescue Troutman. No, I'm not. Again, I'm here for peace talks. They sent me for the peace talks. Yeah,
peace talks. He's a lot of misconceptions going on at Rambo. He just tries to, you know, lie and not take any blame, I think.
Or he's protecting the child from, like, I don't know.
Maybe. But then he hands him his knife.
Yeah, let's watch this.
Are you scared?
No answer. Are you scared? No answer. Why no answer? He could have said,
I wonder if that was just Sylvester Stallone getting sick of this kid and just not answering him anymore.
Very well could have been. Or it was Rambo doing that old, yeah, I get afraid, just like anyone else, but I can't admit that either. So I'm not going to lie. I'll just stay silent. You know?
He should have went into the Rocky 3, I'm afraid speech right there.
Or Rocky 5. Yo, your best friend is Frankie Fear. See, Frankie Fear is in your corner. See,
your fear is a fighting best friend. Who's your friend in Orlando, Tommy?
Yeah, who's your best friend in Orlando, Tommy? I don't know, Charlie. No, it's Frankie Fear. See, I love Tommy's face in that scene. He's like, oh my gosh, this guy might literally have brain damage. Remember Tommy's face? He's like, this is weird. It was very awkward. That whole conversation is very awkward.
Oh, a lot of Rocky V is very awkward, but.
Hot take. Here's a hot take for my tease on my show. I think Rocky V is aging better than Rocky Balboa.
I 100% agree with you, Ryan. I'm a big advocate of Rocky V. I have been for a long time. I think it's very misunderstood.
Well, sure.
You know, I don't like that Sly kind of disowned it a little bit over the years.
He did. I love Sly, but he has such a big ego that he can't, because fans hated it, he has to.
He had to hate it, right?
Right.
He couldn't stand by it.
Imagine if he said, you know what, guys? I know it's a bit misunderstood, but there's a lot of heart. It's a family drama. He felt like he had to be cool with the kids. And
right.
I also heard a rumor that he may be doing a recut.
Yes, I heard that rumor too, because they're going to release the 1-4
on 4K,
I think.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So
hopefully that's true.
I could talk forever about Rocky V as well. Okay. I'll say that for my Rocky. Again, that's a little tease. If you're not listening to my Rocky podcast, listen to my Rocky podcast. Okay.
Rocky Five conversation continued there.
Well, and speaking of Rocky Five, it was 2 years after this film was Rocky Five, if you can believe it.
Oh, okay, right. Yeah, 1998, right.
And so 90. Look at Sly's build here. So I always said Sly's build in Rocky Five was a missed opportunity for him to step in the ring with Tommy at the end, because he looked amazing in Rocky
right.
Five.
Mm-hmm. You just get that shower scene, you know?
Yeah, we do get the shower scene.
My hands from shaking.
I was in the shower, you see, and I was shaking in the shower, Adrian, you know what I'm saying? But now I can't stop.
I just want to go home, Mick. Mick.
All right, so now the kid's pointing at the knife. What's this?
It's a knife.
Can you see this?
Sure.
So he plays with the knife, shows a little bit of moves, showing that, look at me, look how much of a warrior I am.
Very right. Irresponsible of Rambo here, giving this kid. I have a pocket knife, like a little... I'm not that I'm in a gang or anything, but I have a little knife in my house. It's very sharp. I've accidentally cut myself with this thing 20 times.
Well, look at the kid here. He's palming
his
chin here.
He's swinging around a massive knife.
It's half his body length, and he's holding the blade in his hand right there. Look at that. That should cut his hand.
And Rambo just doesn't even try to stop him. He just wants the kid to slice his jugular. Like,
yeah, please kill yourself. Oh, it wasn't me. Sorry.
Hey, kid, can I have it?
Very good. Can I have it? No. And Rambo tells the truth here. Yeah.
What is this?
So now the boy is pulling on the necklace. What is this? This is, of course, the necklace that Ko gave. Or not gave Rambo. Mm-hmm. Well, she gave it via her death.
Right.
And again,
you're not expendable, Rambo.
You're not expendable. Not till 2000.
That's a good title for a movie. You know he was sitting on that for a long time.
I know. I asked that question. Did Sly remember that line when he...
Definitely.
Okay. 100%. So, okay, so Ko's dead. Rambo's wearing the necklace. Now he's getting a little bit miffed. He goes, you won everything. This is for luck.
You won everything. This is for luck.
What is luck?
Luck is...
I'm actually pissed off at this guy. Because I wanted to hear Rambo's explanation for luck.
Mm-hmm.
He was about to... Luck is...
Right. That's a whole movie right there, him explaining luck. I like the way he doesn't... I mean, not that he's going to give it to him anyway, but he's just like, I need the luck more than you, kid. You've had enough bad luck. Everybody in your family's dead. I can't do anything for you.
Yeah, your luck's run out, brother. You might not make the end of this film. I'm not going to lie to you. I need to do part four in 20 years.
Can I have it? I need luck.
So do I.
I need luck.
The kid just told him to F off.
Basically.
He says, look, what a child, always like this. Look annoying. That. We'll let this dialogue play out. So the guide, I always forget his name, Hussad, he's now going to explain their national sport. So their national sport's not hockey, it's not baseball, it's dragging a carcass to circles. So let's listen to the explanation.
Dragging a carcass through the desert, dropping it in a circle.
You know how the sport probably started? Literally, they're probably two guys out or a group of people, you know, traveling. They came across a dead animal. And somebody picked it up to see if it was worthy to eat or something for food. And the buddy dragged it from him, took it from his hands, and they tried to pull it back. And they ran around.
Right.
Right? And then it became like okay, so.
Now, have you checked, is this a real sport?
I didn't Google it because he says it's the national sport. Like, it's got to be real. Can you imagine the Super Bowl of the sport? What's it called again? Carcass drag or something? I can't remember.
Yeah, I don't remember the name.
Let's see how this works. Shirts versus skins. I don't know who's on whose team. I don't. Here's the explanation. It's a national sport.
It's a national sport. Old insane game. Maybe 3,000 years old. Look, they never stop playing it. War, not war. They don't mind. You like it?
I'll take football.
Laugh track. Laugh track.
Laugh track.
Not really.
Laugh track. Let me do that. So he says, what do you do with football? Play with your foot? He goes, not really. That's another laugh track. The idea being football is only very little kicking. Which is weird because there's a lot of running, which require feet, last time I checked. But So they're playing. Rambo's watching. He's kind of like admiring the manlihood of the game. You know, he's looking at the game. He's like, that's really... And
it's
we
like,
know
put
that,
me in, coach.
Put me in, coach. That's awesome. And remember, Rambo, the character, is a horse. He's a horseman by trade. So he was raised on a ranch with horses. He's a horse handler. Mm-hmm. So seeing these guys playing a horse game really intrigues him. You know, he's getting his, you know, he's starting to reminisce about the old days in Arizona. And then we have the one handsome Afghanistan side actor invites Rambo.
The guy
to play.
They knew was going to be on camera a lot, you know?
He's the most aesthetically pleasing extra they have in the camp. And of course, he invites Rambo to play. Come on, play, American.
He should have did a callback to this in the newest Rambo. He should have played this game on his ranch.
Oh, yeah. See, look at this guy. He's like the Afghanistan Sly. Look at those arms and those pipes. He's a big boy.
What are they saying? They want you to try. It's a way to welcome you to be with them. If you want to try, go ahead, but...
I'm throwing around a dead animal.
The guide who saw it saying they want you to play, that's their way of welcoming you into the group, the community. Fair enough, you know, come join the fun. What I love about Sly, bless his heart, I love how he always has to insert himself in some sort of physical type of... Like, he did that in lockup, remember? He played football with the prisoners.
Oh, yeah. You're dead, Leone! Leone, you're a dead man!
I freaking love lockup.
Oh, my God, lockup. I saw it way too young as well. Like, that's scary. Yeah. I was like, I'm never going to jail. I'm never doing anything wrong.
That's because... a scared straight film, man.
Yo, it really is. They should show that in elementary schools. Like, they should show that in kindergarten classes. You keep your life in check if you see lockup at that age.
Hot take, lockup is my favorite... non-Rocky Rambo Sly film. I love that film.
Lockup's a good movie, honestly. Very underrated.
It's probably, put this way, it's his most, everyone talks Copland. Copland's
good. I gotta watch it. I haven't watched it in a while, so I have to rewatch it.
It's kind of a rough go. I hate to say, Sly's great in it. He's good in it, but he's not overshadowed, but he's great with everyone else that's great. And that's the, if you want to talk about a Sly performance, the problem with that film is, how should I say this? He's on par with everyone that already acts good. Ray Liotta, Robert De Niro, Harvey Keitel. These guys are always
Robert
good.
Patrick's in that movie too, right?
These guys are A-game all the time. Or for a larger part of their career when it comes to acting chops. So Sly brought it, and he measured up, and he did it. But Robert De Niro just, you blew it. You got that?
You deaf bastard, you blew it.
That scene is hilarious. He's eating the sandwich. I don't. They don't put any ham in the sandwich. I don't put the ham.
Lockup definitely underrated. Doesn't get enough respect.
And I think he does just as good as acting job in Lockup as he does in Copland. Like, it's a great dramatic performance. And name me another movie where you cry when the car dies.
Oh man. Really?
It's true. I've never cried during a car death scene. No. An automobile has died and I'm crying.
What are the rules?
Well, you have to take the sheep once around and then throw it in the circle.
Why?
Because there is a circle there.
That's it.
So many laugh tracks, I can't.
That's another, it's another comedy moment right there.
Because there's a circle there.
Why? He makes so many of them.
Another laugh track. I
you know what it is, too? The Rambo character's just... He's so serious that, like, those jokes just miss. You know?
Well, we'll let the scene play out because, obviously, it's all visual. But we can talk over it while it's playing. Again, I love how Sly writes this. You see how straight his back was when he was on that horse? He was just, like a knight.
Right.
You know? So now the game has started. Everyone starts running towards the sheep in the circle. I guess first one to grab it wins type thing. Or they have to grab the sheep. There you go.
Somebody needs to take this video and put a score in the top right corner or whatever.
Oh, I can't keep score. I don't know who's on. Is it every man for themselves? Or is it, as much as we're joking, great act, like horse galloping filming sequences are a lot of fun to watch.
Oh, yeah. This movie, honestly, a lot of good shots in this movie. Even the helicopter stuff.
Horses falling, the horses running around. Mm-hmm. And let's be honest, Sly is a great horse handler. We kind of forget, it's Rambo doing on the horse. But it's Sly on the horse. There's no stunt double there. Mm-hmm. He makes it very clear.
You know, he did it 110%. He put in the time. He definitely did. Knowing Sly, he was probably riding horses all day and night to prepare for this scene.
So now he's with that Afghani Sly, and they're tug-of-warring on the carcass together. And he gets knocked off the horse. Again, that's Sly getting knocked off the horse. No stunt doubles for Sly.
Yeah, no, listen. You can't replace that body or that face.
So he's grabbed the carcass. He's on the ground without the horse. And all the horses gather around him. They start beat the crap out of Sly on the Rambo. Like, he gets back on the horse. Literally gets back on his horse and starts playing the game again. And that's what I love about, you know, the Rambo character. It's like, hey, this is the sport. He's not getting mad at getting hit or nothing. I always get really cringy when horses fall.
Yeah, I've heard things about that too. Like back in the day, I don't know what time they, like I heard a lot of the time they would honestly end up killing the horse.
No.
A lot of the time with those moves. Yeah. I mean, I think it was, it predates this film, sure. But I think it was more in like the '60s and the Westerns and stuff like that. But whenever you saw like something happen crazy with a horse, it would end up breaking its legs and shit. So.
Well, watch the stunt work by Sly. So he picks the sheep carcass off the ground, full gallop with the horse. And of course, they do slow it down, as they should. That Rambo pulls, Sylvester Stallone pulls off the stunt. I don't think you could put me on a horse for 10 years and I could ever pull this off.
Oh my God, no. I would definitely fall off the horse and then get trampled by the horse.
Yeah, so let's watch this play out, because this is a legit stunt. And let's watch it a couple times to break it up. So he's galloping at full speed, and the slide goes down. Picks that carcass off the ground.
Crazy.
Now, you see the guy next to him? Now, is that guy a stunt worker? They're all stunt guys. But now the guy holding the horse, now, I think we're led to believe he's holding the horse to try to get Rambo. But do you think that's a stunt handler to hold the horse steady?
100%. 100%. He might even be – something might be attached to Sly that he's holding him by, because I doubt he doesn't have any support, like, you know, or something.
So in the movie, we're led to believe it's just the guy's trying to check Rambo. I think it's to steady the line of horses. I wonder, what do you think?
There's an area in the back that it's not visible. There might even be somebody in the back doing something too, you know, that we don't see.
I don't think so. It looks pretty – we can actually – like, you know, the beauty about YouTube is you can actually slow the speed down real quick here. Let me just go a quarter
speed. Right, right.
So let's watch this. So,
yeah, look at that. Yeah, you know what? There's nobody in the back, definitely. No.
But he manages to get the – complete sideways on the horse, picks it up.
Yeah.
And the stunt guy there, what's he?
Yeah, he's doing something.
He's holding Sly's leg or something there. You see that?
There has to be something. There has to be something holding or attached to Sly's leg, because, yet again, I don't think like the studio would. I mean, they probably were like scared that this guy was going to do the shot anyway.
Yeah, so he did the stunt. It's still a stunt all the same. The incredible strength.
Oh, yeah. No, definitely.
Yeah. We should have mentioned, of course, during this, we're about to see it right now, but during this, again, we'll keep it on mute and keep the picture moving for our YouTube viewers as well and talk through it for our audio listeners, because it's just an action sequence that has no dialogue.
Right.
During that whole horse plane, the Russian, we spoke to earlier in the episode, the Russians are, the disperse, which is a great kind of movie storytelling that we're seeing the village is lighthearted, they're having fun, and unbeknownst to them, the enemy's coming.
Right, exactly.
That juxtaposition.
It's all fun and games.
It's all fun and games until the Russians blow you away. here we go. So the Russians are coming over the village. They're spotted, by the villagers. Horse game ends. And these helicopters, with their endless ammo, of course, as Rambo films have, endless ammo, start just blowing up villagers and everyone in this village. And it's really, obviously, in real life, it's great. Look at that. Okay, sorry, I'm talking all over the place here. Look at that sequence. Oh, look at that action sequence right here. Right here. So you have the helicopter coming behind Afghani Sly and Sly.
Afghani Sly.
I told you this guy was like a movie star stunt guy as well, and he's handsome.
Definitely.
Right? So he's with Sly, and they're being chased by the helicopter. Look at that stunt work there. That's really them.
No, that's
explosion.
You don't get that anymore. That's one thing you don't get with like modern action movies is that those
look at that
real
shot right there.
You know, genuine stunts.
That's look no that. CGI. That's a helicopter behind those guys with fireballs going.
And that's not a face paste of somebody else's face on another body or something like that. That's Stallone. He's in there.
These things are missed. I miss this, and I think when I watch, when I watch this film, I think that's why I like it more. At the time, that's all we had. But now that we watch these Marvel films, which are okay, there's just so much like CGI.
Everything's just CGI. Yeah,
like nothing.
It's just different action movies. You know, if you watch the Fast and the Furious movies, it's like a cartoon at that point.
Well, yeah,
you know?
I feel like I'm just watching a video game cutscene.
Right. Exactly.
I definitely
have a new appreciation.
Which is why I'll say this right now: why I like or love Tom Cruise. And his films.
You got to respect Tom Cruise. He's a wacko, but you got to respect him.
Sure. His religious, we get the sake as a Scientology, but you know, in all fairness, if you, you know, whatever religion, You know, mm-hmm. I know Scientology has its issues, but so do Catholics. Let's be honest. Catholicism,
oh, of course, everybody.
Mm-hmm. You know, every religion has their kind of dark history. It's just that we're seeing the dark 100%. History live. We're seeing the history live with Scientology, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
But as a film actor, he entertains mm-hmm. like, and he does all of his stunts.
Oh no, he especially at that age. You know, what actor is going to put themselves at the risk of an injury? You know.
Well, you saw the latest one that he did, Fallout. I think it was Fallout was the latest one.
Broke his leg, right?
Broke his ankle jumping that building.
Right,
and they
that's
kept
crazy.
It in. You can actually see the ankle break. They paused it.
Oh, gosh.
And there's a sequence where when he gets on the building, you can actually go on YouTube because he showed it on a talk show. And he hobbles. He jumps. He climbs up onto the building after he jumped it. After he broke mm-hmm. his ankle, and he still runs off screen, keeps rolling. You know, film's rolling. He still runs on the broken foot.
Yeah, like, he's dedicated, man. He's like the last of the that kind of movie star. You know, I think
him and Vin Diesel. Let's generation. Be honest, Vin Diesel. His quality of movie and his acting abilities together combined, it's just yeah. Those two. It's a hard. We should do a poll on our Twitter. Who's a better action star and actor combined? Vin Diesel or Tom Cruise?
Mr. Potato Head or Tom Cruise?
Mission Impossible Fallout is actually a near mm-hmm. perfect action film. It is an amazing film.
Yeah, they got those movies got better.
They
got better.
It's
over
weird.
Time.
How do they get better with each one?
It's so crazy. And it kind of snuck up on you too. Like you're like, wow, this movie's actually really good.
I consider parts 4, 5, and 6, those last four, the three, I mean, the four, yes. That's like a trilogy on their own. They're like those.
Those are the best ones.
Yeah,
those are the best ones.
So they're doing the, what's it called now? The final two. They're doing two right now. Filming.
They're doing a part. Yeah, they're breaking it up, right? Yeah. In two parts. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, sorry. Yeah, and the talk on Maverick was great too. So,
oh god, yeah.
But what we're saying,
just
the
whole how they film that,
yeah, it's amazing.
Too crazy.
And the reason why we got on this tangent, folks, is because here we're seeing that aesthetically, it's more aesthetically pleasing to watch the kind of the mm-hmm. real danger on the film. On film, you're watching this real stunt.
It's like anything; your eyes recognize it. You know, it's like when you're watching a horror movie and there's CGI blood, and
yeah,
it just takes something out of it.
This looks fantastic. So that helicopter's flying low. Great, great looking. I said before, these big Russian helicopters that they got for this movie, they just look badass. Even mm-hmm. from 88 to now, they have this kind of this beastly, this.
Yeah, it's like a monster coming from above. Like,
yeah. So watch these action sequences again. The set pieces of explosions and squibs and horses falling mm-hmm. and all these are all stuntmen, you know. Let's give them full credit. All these squibs going off. Yeah. Look at that horse falling on its neck.
Exactly.
How does it
nowadays? This would be all CGI.
Yeah, I don't know if they would do that kind of horse falling today because those horses are on their necks. I don't.
Yeah, that's what I mean. If you look into it, I don't know. I don't remember all the details, but there was some stuff that was done back in the day that was definitely inhumane.
Yeah, I. So they're right there, the Sly gets off the horse, puts his back on the wall, explosions go around through the wall on him. Mm-hmm. Women and children are being blown to pieces.
Right,
they only said there was 100 people in this village. They said that earlier. I don't know. I've seen the same 100 people running around. they're all going to
same exactly.
I say there's about 500 people, but if it's 100 people, they're all running crisscross back and forth. You know, where do I go? Please.
This guy's lousy aim. You think he would have wiped out everybody with the helicopter, but
they're kind of funny with their aim. Now Rambo, mm-hmm. as we see, he's just running. He's going towards the one machine gun they have in camp. I think that's what he's running towards. But check how low the copter's flying there. Do you see that? On the ground.
Yeah.
Look at that. That's a cool shot right there.
That's crazy too, yeah.
So the helicopter's going through, and again, the over-the-shoulder shots of the pilots in the helicopter. So I love those. They did it in Rambo Part 2 as well. Mm-hmm. Through the windshield mm-hmm. again, no CGI. So you're seeing that real aerial footage with the camera in through the helicopter on the ground.
Great stuff.
Now we got Yuri here. Remember the Russian? He's helping the boys. So I love this. So so Yuri goes down. The blaze goes. So he saves the boy from being killed. And I love how we're led to believe that the Russian officer knows that Yuri's there. And he made that attack personal that he took out Yuri.
Right.
So, of course, Rambo finally makes it to the turret or whatever. Finally gets to the one piece of, like, real defense that they have in this camp. And then he does great sequence here of just taking out this helo here.
Great.
No.
Nothing better. This is what Rambo's all about. Like,
now we're finally
Sylvester
seeing
Stallone
it.
Holding a gun that's just shaking his whole body. Yeah.
Now, what did that part remind you of in Rambo 4, that little sequence there?
What did it remind me of from Rambo 4?
Yeah.
When he kills everybody, when he's shooting everybody with that gun?
So this, I've said this before maybe too many times, but maybe people are listening to this episode mm-hmm. for the first time because you're here as a guest, and I know your mm-hmm. fan base will come pouring into my channel. So Rambo 4, that sequence when he took out everyone with the 50 cal, that's where it should have been in that film, where this was in this film, where Rambo got the gun, the turret, took out the helicopter. Great action, but that wasn't the end of the film. That's mm-hmm. the thing that Rambo, the fourth film, lacked, was why did they make that the finale? It was an incredible action sequence, don't get me wrong, but
right.
they should have made it so that happened. The main military guy, Burma leader, ran away. And Rambo just takes him out with a little gut slice, and that's it. And I thought,
Right. He rolls down the hill or whatever, doesn't he?
They should have mm-hmm. had it so he gets back to a camp, and they should have had a quick 20-minute solo mission where him and the surviving members of that attack go into the camp and take out the Burma soldiers like a video game.
Yeah. I like Rambo 4. I mean, there's some things about it. The traditional Rambo fan in me, you know, wanted to see.
I don't think it's as good.
I wanted to see Stallone with no shirt on. He's wearing that big giant T-shirt the whole movie.
Yeah,
he looks like a vein. He's at the point where he's just evolved into a giant vein. He's like evolved as like a Pokemon or something into something else. I don't know. His hair doesn't look right in that movie either.
I think people love that film because of the violence. I get it. I think Rambo 3 is more of a Rambo film than Rambo 4.
I think it feels more as a continuation. I mean, and it's similar to what we were saying about Rocky 5 and Rocky 6. I think it's also that too much time had passed at that point, too.
I know. You know? Look, and I love, don't get me wrong, I loved it because, again, and this is what I said about part 5. It's like, at the end of the day, folks, we're getting Sly, calling himself Rambo,
right,
whatever.
Exactly. I think that's another movie too, though. It's perfect what we were just talking about, like the CGI versus the blood squibs of the 80s.
Yeah,
it's just it takes me a little out of it. When you're seeing that CGI stuff in Rambo 4, it takes me a little out of it.
Yeah, they did a little bit of that. I think they've gone away from that, I think, a little bit more again. I don't think we're doing as much CGI.
In the new one, right.
Expendables did CGI. Remember when Eric Roberts got stabbed by the knife at the end of Expendables? It was like literally, wow, great painting, guys. Yeah, that's a cool.
I know, really.
That's a cool cartoon knife through the chest there. I know. If the Friday the 13th movies can have knives go through the chest, I'm sure we can do it in 2006. You know what I mean? Like
Exactly.
Wouldn't it be cheaper?
I would think so. I don't know. Maybe it's more work because they have to go and they have to make the stuff and
makeup.
You know,
rip the shirt with the knife going.
Right.
I don't know.
Anyway. Exactly.
All right. The battle's ended. The surviving copter that was with the main. I love how the main Russian bad guy is flying the copter. It's like he's making it personal. Right.
He's got nobody else to do it for him. Like he's like, no, I'm gonna take the helicopter.
It's like Trauman doing that mission. There's no reason why he should be doing the mission. He has no business doing that mission. He's a full bearded colonel. There's no reason.
Like 70 years old. He's like, why are you going?
And he did not. All he did was fire his machine gun at nothing, and then he got caught. It was the most. This is a guy that trained Rambo. It was embarrassing.
Rambo, so he should be a badass himself.
He should be, or he should be at least a little smarter. Like, it's, yeah, I don't know.
Right.
Okay, so let's watch the sequence here of, now this is where with this makeup on Sly, after the, you know, the debris on his face, this is where his lips look really pronounced. It was this sequence here where I thought,
look at this.
Yeah. Especially when he's talking, it comes later when he talks to the guy at the end here. So he's just seen war again. He's seen death and destruction. He's taken it in. It's his war now, as you will say later.
Mm-hmm. Now it's personal.
Look at all these dead bodies everywhere, the smoke, the debris. He's seen this before. He knows.
Mm.
You know, he knows what this is. Now, this is a great little sequence. The leader, the guy that looks like Omar Sharif, is going to come up and talk to Rambo. I love when we see these bodies laid out. Great, but a great, like, dead bodies everywhere, smoke.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Great shot right there.
Yeah. Look at that hair.
Coming out of the smoke. Perfect.
Look at that hair. It's too much. It's too much.
I need to figure out a way to get that hair. I mean, there's nothing I could do.
I think it was after this film where Sly's like, I gotta do something about the front. No matter how much I do in the back.
Quick question. Do you think... Because I have, I mean,
I think
Stallone has fake hair now.
Oh, are you kidding? Do I think? Man, his hairline.
Him and Frank?
Oh, come on now. His hair, he's like Burt Reynolds. How can your hair get further in the front the older you get?
Right. I think it was sometime in the late 90s.
No, it was this film. There's sequences here. Where he puffs that up in the front. That's what I mean. He's distracting us for what's going on in the front. I think it was after this film where he's like, I got to do something.
Yeah. I think at this point he's probably full blown, you know, he's got nothing on top, but he probably don't even leave his house without getting that done.
Yeah, he actually has hair plugs. There are hair plugs. They're plugs. He has plugs.
Okay.
And it's a real process that you can do. I forget which actor it was and celebrity it was, but they were on a podcast. Not a big time celebrity, but he fully admitted it.
Right.
He just said like, yeah.
Hey, listen.
Because he talked about the process. They literally put in one hair at a time.
Right, I've heard of that.
And they go through it's patches. Now, I'm very lucky. I'm 47 and I've lucked out here.
Mm-hmm. No, listen, you got a great hairline there. You should grow out the mullet, I think.
You know, my brothers are like your brother. I'm your brother. My brothers are all bald. I have three brothers and they're all bald.
But you got the good gene, basically.
I'm very nice, though. I never make fun of it. I've never, because I know it can be, I guess Italians, you guys bust your balls. You bust your balls, you know, a little bit more.
Right. I make fun of it myself. I laugh about it. It is what it is.
You did the right thing. Don't grow your hair out. Embrace it.
No. Just
Patrick Stewart that.
Don't do the Hulk Hogan. No. Advise against the Hulk Hogan.
Here we go. We have Omar Sharif, and we'll end it after this scene here. We have Omar Sharif.
This scene makes me laugh, too, because he looks like he didn't even fight or run. He looks like he didn't even get dirty. Like, where was he?
What's that on his back there? You see that? What's that on his back?
Oh, yeah.
What is that?
I don't know what the hell that is. The white, right?
Can anyone in our chat see that? Donald, what do you...
What? I wonder, is that lighting? Is that, like, lighting? No, let's go back a bit.
No, it looks like a scotch tape. Look, right there. It really pokes out.
Yeah, I wonder what that is. I'm surprised they didn't catch that, whatever that is.
Is that like a wire for an earpiece or something, or
maybe it's possible?
Right there, it looks like there might be something under his shirt a little bit.
Right.
Is it an earpiece for his lines? It's like okay. Mm-hmm. He's like, all right, Sly. Now say, yeah.
No. Now say good luck. Don't answer when he asks you what luck is. Yeah.
It's like what's luck? And Sly's like luck is. What do you think he would have said? Okay,
luck, you know, it's kind of like when you're gonna fight, like in a fight, and you do good, you go the distance with Apollo, you know. It's kinda...
The kid's like, "What's an Apollo?"
You know, Apollo Creed. He's the best.
He's the best. No one's better. You know, yeah, time defeated him. time defeats everybody. You gotta change.
We should have threw in the towel.
I would love to do a whole like Sly like with dementia, you know, all of his just talks from his bedside.
Just all the roles blend into one, you know.
It turns blue.
One time they froze me and I had to come back and fight Wesley Snipes, you know, and he had blonde hair.
Why is Apollo Creed a demolition man? Sly, 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 that's not true. They're not all the same. Stop it, Sly, stop.
They're not all the same. They don't look the same.
Why is Wesley Snipes in a Rocky 2? I don't get it. So I don't know what it's on his back there. That's weird. There's something taped.
Yeah, it is weird.
Now you see how it is here.
Now I love that. Okay, that first line. So the guy says, the leader, he goes, now you see what it's like here. Well, no, it wasn't like this at all when I got here. It was actually quite peaceful and...
I think I actually brought this with me.
Yeah. It's actually my fault.
There's an argument to be made. They're trying to kill him.
Oh, that is hilarious. Rambo's like keeping his mouth shut. They could be here because of me.
Yeah. This was like this before, right? They're not trying to kill me, right?
It's always been this way. You're right. Yeah. I got nothing to do with it. I love how everyone's dead around. All of this guy's like co-workers, community is dead around him. But he's got to have like this thoughtful spiritual conversation with Rambo.
And he doesn't even look like he was damaged or anything.
Oh,
like,
no. Well,
he went to go hide somewhere.
Yeah. We noticed, Rambo, you literally ran away.
We just watched you run as everybody else got shot.
But I'm the one that fired that gun. That was me.
But there was a big gun over there. I had to get to it. What was I going to do? I saw it earlier in the day.
Just before the horses, I saw it. So he goes on to say the big somewhere in war. Here we go.
Somewhere in war, there's supposed to be honor. Where is the honor here? What?
Where is he? So, yeah, fair point. Yeah. But is that true? Is that old school thinking? I know we don't bomb hospitals per se. We're not supposed to, but I think every side everywhere has done that sort of thing. I think, oops.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You got to win, right?
But this guy does a great job acting here in all series. And he goes, yeah, where's the honor in this? Mm-hmm. Where? Of course, now he's, again, this is like a to the American audience. We're seeing this as an American mm-hmm. audience. We're seeing this like.
They might as well at this point, like, turn to the camera and just look you in the eyes.
Look what happens when you bomb hospitals and safety zones, so to speak. Mm-hmm.
We are taking the survivors to the border. Are you coming?
His lips here.
Going to the forest.
Look.
Ooh. Have you not seen death?
See?
Go.
Mm-hmm.
Go while you can. This is not your war.
It is now. It is now.
His lips look inflamed here.
Definitely. I could see him, you know, he seems like a vain guy. I could see him, you know, getting work done early in his career, too. At the peak, he's probably constantly looking at his, you know, his appearance on film.
What are you going to do for Paulie? You got your face fixed up?
You know, fix me up. It turned into a freaking loser. That's what we should watch, Paulie's lines with the subtitles on, because Burt Young is just amazing.
In our One More Round podcast, yeah, we talked about the mm-hmm. scene where he's at the Christmas time and he's like, she's busted. And she's busted. She ain't a virgin anymore. Yeah, she goes, she ain't a virgin anymore. And so he's squeaking that out. But you know what else he says? He yells at Adrian when she runs away, when she does that run away. Ah! When she runs, when she runs away screaming after Paulie. He yells out, you let a man pull your pants down. That's what he screamed at her.
That had to be in Stallone's script, right?
He yells it out.
Like, Burt Young was improvising.
He might have been improvising. You let a man pull your pants down.
Have to watch that again.
And Rocky's amazing. Like, well, she pulled her own pants down, Paulie.
It's cold. It's cold outside, Paulie.
That's what I mean about the captions. You got to watch these films with the captions. Mm-hmm. The first Rocky film, mm-hmm. you'll catch that, especially Paulie's talk. Look at Sly's lips here. Look at those. Are those the same lips that he had in Rocky II?
No, I don't think so.
Which was only 9 years ago.
Honestly, speaking of, you know, when he eventually evolved to the giant vein in Rocky IV, like, that's even a difference if when you watch Rocky I and II and then go into Rocky III and IV.
Right.
He starts becoming a different human being right there. Like, he doesn't even look like he has the same head anymore. I don't know what he was doing to himself.
But how psyched is Adrian? How psyched is Adrian?
Oh, yeah.
Can you imagine, like, you're a woman, that's your husband. You met him in Rocky, the first Rocky film, and he turns into Rocky IV.
He was all pale and doughy in Rocky I, and then Rocky IV, he's, like, in the best shape of his life. He's all oiled up.
Even Talia Shire during the training sequences, even she was, like, sliding mm-hmm. on the floor. She was so wet. I know. She was like, I don't even think she was faking it. She's like, oh man, I get the, yeah.
Physical, him and Carl Weathers running on the beach wearing, like, I wish I could wear short shorts like that and get away with it and cut off shirts because they're in such good shape, like, to bolt it up.
I can't, I could not pull that off. But this guy here, Omar Sharif, says to Rambo, you're a good friend. They've known each other 5 hours.
five minutes. Like, they barely know him. Like, all he did was just bring the hellish rain from above to their life, and you're a good friend. He's essentially done nothing at this point. He ran over to a gun and started shooting.
Yeah, Rambo is responsible for the deaths of at least 50 to 75 people. You're a good friend. Boy, with friends like that, you do not need enemies.
Whoa. Please leave. Like,
speaks a foreign language to him. Goes, oh, shit, whatever.
He thinks he understands after playing the dead carcass game. Like, he's one of them now.
He's part of the community. That's right. He's learned the language.
I don't know what he just said.
So now Hussar comes up to talk to him.
Stay.
I will show you the way.
I will go too.
No, you go with them.
I will not. They kill all my family. I want to fight.
Not with me. You go. Go on.
Rambo appreciates the fight in that boy. It's not the size of the dog and the fight, it's the size of the fight and the dog, right?
I could picture Rambo in another universe taking the kid with him and then using him as a shield as they shoot.
Or no, better yet, he uses him for the landmine. He just keeps tossing the kid ahead of him. It's safe to go, right? You go walk ahead and boom, yeah.
He was practicing with the carcass and now he's doing it with the kid's carcass.
he can come back with the boy's carcass and play the game. Look, guys!
Why must you do this?
Because he do it for me.
There you go. This who saw it can't believe it. Even he can't believe that Rambo would go to the hornet's nest for one man. And he goes, why would you do this? Because you do it for me.
You would do it for me. He calls me John.
He calls me Johnny. Only he does. Now, I love this slow saunter. Okay, now we got to have you walk away. The music, cue the music. The fires are going smoke, and you're going to be solemn. And look at that backside in his arms. You know, look, he's just...
And that thing is gone, whatever that was on his under his tank top. They caught it.
Yeah, it's gone. You know what it might have been? I kid you not. I got a theory. It was an earpiece wire taped to his backside, probably to cue him when things were going to happen for explosions or something, maybe.
That makes sense. Yeah, that definitely makes sense.
So that's what they call, ladies and gentlemen, a film flub. We saw a film flub. This is what you get when you do this film scene by scene. All right. Well, there you go.
You get the good stuff.
That's the end of this sequence of events, because I believe the next one is, let's just see real quick here. I think this is a good place to end. This is where I wanted to end. There's a whole other scene coming up.
Perfect.
So, Dom, how did you like your guest spot?
Great, man. This is great. A lot of fun. I love talking about Sly movies. Always down.
I'm not surprised it went as well as it did. I know your stuff. I listened to your podcast. I've seen your humor reels. I knew you're exactly... I've wanted a podcast with you for some time. I don't know why it's fallen through.
I like I said, when I was looking at the last one, I saw it was like kind of in the times before COVID. And then
I guess so.
When that happened, it was
just life in general.
Time just slipped away. Yeah.
And then when I went to your Twitter to invite you, so I went to your Twitter because I knew you were going to be a guest host. I went to the Twitter to invite you and I saw like, oh, he still has his Spotify or whatever link to your podcast. So I thought, well, it's probably his old one that he stopped doing. But then I clicked on it. He's like, oh, he's got a new podcast again called Movie Thoughts. I highly recommend it.
Movie Thoughts.
Dom is funny on it, but he's fair. I think your reviews are fair. I think they're funny and
thank
fair.
You, man.
You do a good job saying spoilers are coming up. Again, you do recent films. So if you're a fan of recent films, you do some old school stuff too. And you do a great job. It's not easy not having a co-host in some ways, but it's also fun to have a co-host to bounce off with.
Absolutely.
I actually want to do a Western podcast. I'm going to start one after the Rambo series is done. That's my next project.
That's an awesome idea, yeah.
Yeah, I've thought about what you're doing. Do I do it by myself? Because then I'm thinking if I do it by myself, I could start recording episodes right now without releasing them.
Right away, right. Yeah, that's the thing. There's nothing holding you back at that point.
I could just, I got a half hour to carve out. I'll just talk about this part of the film. So anyways, this is behind the scenes stuff nobody cares about. But I just, I get why people do it on their own because it's just your schedule. You don't have to bug anybody.
Exactly.
So Donald said, hilarious episode, guys. Bring Dom back as soon as possible.
Definitely.
He'll be curious to see what makes the edit. Yeah, usually the Discord gets a little bit of jokes and stuff that don't make it on. Look, I'm in the military and I'm in the government. I can't be too blue. But anyways, once I retire, I'll be able to be a little bit more blue. But anyways, Dom, it was an absolute pleasure having you on.
This was tons of fun, man. I would definitely come back, whatever, talk about Rocky, talk about Rambo, I don't care.
We'd love to have you back. So Dom, absolutely a wonderful pleasure to have you on. I hope to have you on again, but unfortunately, that's the end of the episode.
I didn't ask you. You asked me. Nothing is over. Nothing. You just don't turn it off.